Father, we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus. And Lord, we're grateful to be here in this place, this day, God. What a joy and a privilege it is to lift our hands and our hearts, lift up our voices in song, praise and adoration of who you are. God, thank you for the things that you've already done today. Lord, we're just so grateful for your goodness and your presence. Now, Lord, we acknowledge that Jesus Christ is the senior leader. And you've sent your Holy Spirit, who is the teacher, the revelator of the church. Holy Spirit, be our teacher, be our guide. Give us the vision, the wisdom, the instruction, the direction, even the correction we need for our lives. Today, we don't look to a man or a woman, to the young or the old, to the black, the white, the brown, any other color we could imagine. We look to you. So open our eyes to see. Open our ears to hear, Lord. We pray that you open our hearts to have a good understanding. May we be the good ground where the word is sown. And may it produce fruit in each and every one of our individual lives. Lead us into 2016 to your vision, to your will, and your way for this house, God. Lord, we praise you and thank you for that. God, we don't just ask this blessing upon ourselves. Also, we'd ask it for all the churches, both here in the Inland Empire, as well as around the planet. They're our brothers and sisters, Lord. And we ask that you would bless them. Bless all of them, God, the Baptists, Lutherans, Methodists, Episcopalians, Charismatics, Pentecostals. God, we thank you for Calvary Chapel, Harvest, God, for the way, for Ecclesia and Trinity and Emmanuel Baptist, God, for Victory and the Foursquare denominations, God, the Assemblies, Lord, all the great churches that are out there, God. We bless our Catholic brothers and sisters and Adventist brothers and sisters, Lord, those that meet on the Sabbath, God. Lord, if they're your people called by your name, if they're lifting up the name of Jesus, preaching your gospel truth, Lord, we bless them as you would bless us. And God, also, we don't forget our persecuted brothers and sisters scattered abroad throughout the world. We ask that you would cover them, protect them, deliver them from the hand of their enemies, God. That, Lord, that they would endure to the end because of the grace and the strength of God given to them, Lord. And we praise you and thank you for it. Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement, and we say, amen. Today, if you got your Bibles, go with me to the book of Acts, chapter number 2. We're going to start there in the Word, but I want to just take a moment in review. This is Vision Weekend, part number 2. If you remember, we talked about building a passionate house. If we were going to say just one kind of tagline or one thing that this year is going to be about, if we've got a vision and a direction that we're going, that one statement would be building a passionate house. Now, remember, we talked about the house of God and where did we get this idea. And in order to know where we're going, we have to know where we've been. And so even the name, the Rock Church and World Outreach Center, where did that come from? What is that all about? And we talked about our seven pillars, our DNA, who we are. You can get a hold of the message, listen to that in more detail. Also, we've got the seven pillars on both sides of the foyer that you can take a look at the distinctives of who we are as a church. But you remember, we were talking about Jesus and his disciples. Okay, and he was asking them, who do the people say that I am out there? And they said, well, some say you're this, some say you're that, some say you're a good teacher, Elijah the prophet. Jesus says, who do you say I am? Peter stepped up and he said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Now Jesus gets excited and he says, Peter, this wasn't revealed to you by flesh and blood. You didn't hear this out there on the street, but rather this was revealed to you by my Father who is in heaven. And so the very next verse, Matthew chapter 16, verse number 18, Jesus says, and I say that you are Peter. He changed his name, Petra. And he says, and upon this rock, I will build my church. Now, he's not saying he's going to build the church on Peter. He's saying that he's going to build it on the confession of who Jesus is as the Christ. And for any church that's out there, we have a twofold purpose. You remember this? Winning souls and making disciples. Everything that we do comes from that purpose. That's why our vision comes from it. The Inland Empire shall be saved. How are we going to do that? By winning souls and making disciples. All of our DNA comes from that and flows through that. And so the rock really is Jesus. He's the foundation that was laid. No other foundation can be laid except that which is already laid, and his name is Jesus. And when we build the house of God, we are building what he is building. We're building right alongside Jesus what he's passionate about. Remember, we said that passion was three things, really. You remember the first one was that it was an intense desire. That if we're going to be passionate and build a passionate house, there has to be intense desire. Secondly, there has to be strong emotion. There needs to be an emotional connection to what it is that we're doing. Otherwise, we'll disconnect from it. And then finally, if we're going to build a passionate house, there had to be fervent activity or action. And remember, we said this about passion is that often passion is seen, it's not really defined, okay? And the disciples saw Jesus, he went into the house of God, he had a strong desire for people to respect and reverence the house of God, and because of that, here comes the emotions, right? He got angry. Because he saw people that were abusing the house of God, and because of that, he didn't just leave that on the inside. He was angry, but he did not sin, and the passion came out of him, and he braided that cord of whips, and he drove all the animals out of the temple. He told the money changers to get out. He overturned their tables. He poured out their money boxes and told them to pick up all their stuff and just get out, right? So we see passion, and we know that if we're going to build a passionate house, that as we look at the lives of the people that call this their church, that this is their home, that we'll be able to see passion on them. What does that look like? Four things. We talked about two of them last week. First one was this, is that we would have a passion for God. All of us, as a goal for this year, 2016, it should be a year of growth personally in the things of God. That we should grow in our wisdom and our knowledge and our experience with God. That we should be flowing with the Holy Spirit more and more. That we should be more and more passionate about the things of God. That I want to be the same Christian I was in 2016 that I was in 2015. I'm going to be growing. Today, I'm getting better than I was yesterday. Why? Because I'm going on and I'm going up with Jesus. This is my passion. It's a passion for God. Remember we said that there's going to be distractions, there's going to be things that come try and take you out. Sin is going to come and try and separate you from God. So you have to guard and you have to protect your walk with God. Also, we said that if you're passionate about God, well, Jesus is building his house. And so if you love God, then you're going to love what he loves and you're going to be passionate about his house. And that will be expressed in our attendance. Whenever you can get into the house of God, that you will be in the building, right? Or in the presence of God, that you're going to get to his house. As well, we talked about this, that if you're passionate about God, not only will you attend church, but also you will give of your resources. And that bank statement is really an accountability statement. It shows where our heart is, where our passion is. That's where we're going to spend our money. That's where we're going to spend our talent. That's where we're going to spend our time and our resource. And therefore, we talked about that tithes and offerings, opportunities for generosity, outreaches, things like that. Freedom for our future, finishing that strong at the end of the next 6 months. If we're passionate and we stay after it and all of us do our part, then we are going to have a paid off church building at the end of this campaign in 6 months' time. But we can't let up. We got to stay passionate, right? And then secondly, remember we said if we love what God loves, well, God loves people. Jesus died for people. Therefore, we have to not only be passionate for God, but we have a compassion for the lost. And we're going to love people who are lost. Why? Because we remember what it was like before we got saved. We're not looking back with longing, but we're looking back saying, look where God has brought me from. Look at what God took me out of. I used to be on the street. I used to be out there doing drugs. I used to think that I was something, but really I was nothing until I got a hold of the one who is everything. His name is Jesus, and I don't want to leave you in that place. I don't want to leave you lost. You're headed for hell, and I love you enough to tell you the truth. And you either get them saved and bring them to church or bring them to church so you can get them saved. Hello. And that's what this is all about, which brings us to today, number three. The third thing for us, not only a passion for God, a compassion for the lost, but remember, we're talking about loving what God loves, and God loves people. Jesus died for people. And that's going to translate into a passionate love for one another. If any place should be loving, it ought to be the church. I should have had more amens than that. If any place should be loving, it ought to be the church. See, church should be so wonderful, so loving, people should be so kind that people on the outside should actually be envious and jealous of the relationships that we have on the inside of church. And yet oftentimes we look at the church and we see that it's not so. It's cliquey. I don't really feel welcome there. I don't feel like I have a spot. I don't feel like I have a place. Well, aside from the peripheral things and some of the stuff that may have happened in different churches or even in this church, okay, we're not blind to it, okay? You're coming into a place with imperfect people. Imperfect things are going to happen. That's just how it is. But if we can understand some things about what God wants for us, we can start to make changes, and as well, we can know that we have a spot here in the house. Church is called three things in the Bible. Really, there's more than that, but three major themes that you see that the church is called. The first one of those things is that we are called the family. Family of God. That God is Father, right? And now, in the Lord, we are all brothers and sisters. Now there's no longer tribes and tongues and cultures and backgrounds, all that kind of stuff. There's not black or white or brown or Asian or Islander or African or whatever it is. Now there is one tribe, there is one nation, there is one God and one Father, one Holy Spirit that's living on the inside of each and every one of us. It's not a lot of different bloods and backgrounds. No, it's one blood that binds us all together, the blood of Jesus now, that covers all of us. We're family. It's a great big family. And you know, sometimes you go to family and it can be awkward and there can be people that you don't really get along with. You know, there's that weird uncle or that crazy aunt, you know, that's always pinching the cheek or whatever it is. But you're family and you belong there. You know it. You look like everyone else, right? You've got that DNA. And maybe you didn't know it, but when you got saved, when you gave your heart and life to Jesus, you became a part of the family of God. And so we're connected to one another. And people might offend you. You may not like everybody. There may be that weird guy over there sitting in the corner. There might be that lady that always has to give you a goofy word when you walk in the back door. We know about that. We understand that. But listen, Jesus died for us all, and he loves us all. And if we can forgive quickly, overlook the offense, if we can stay in love and stay in faith and stay together as family, then can I say it to you like this? Everyone has a place at the table. There's a seat that's been reserved for you. You have a place. You are a part of the family of God. I want to show this to you in the Word of God. You got your Bibles open to the book of Acts. Acts chapter 2. Turn there with me. Oftentimes when people talk about church, they want to look at the early church and see how they did things because they were closer to Jesus and they had the apostles that were there guiding and governing the church. So let's see what they did. Right off the bat, Acts chapter number 2, 3,000 people give their hearts and lives to Jesus. They're baptized, okay? This is the early church, as early as you can get, okay? First sermon's been preached, Holy Spirit's been poured out, and now here they are, and they're gathering together. Acts chapter 2, verse number 42 says this, and they continued steadfastly. That word steadfastly, you could also insert the word passionately, right? They had strong desire. They were emotionally connected, and they had fervent activity. They were steadfast. They were rock steady, okay? They continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine. Now, that word doctrine right there, sometimes we don't understand that. That word doctrine, if I could just break it down for you, very simple, very easy, it just means a system of teaching. That's all. It's all it really is, a system of teaching. So, you know, when we talk about the doctrine of the Holy Spirit, really all that is, it's a system of teaching on the person of the Holy Spirit. Or if we said the doctrine of spiritual gifts, it's a system of teaching about spiritual gifts. So they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine. Now, when we think about church, sometimes that's all we think about. I'm going to go to church, and I'm going to hear a message, right? I'm going to hear the doctrine, the teaching. But look at the early church. What did they do? They continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship. Now, that's not a word that we use too much nowadays. Some of you guys have been in church a long time. You remember fellowship, right? That was the hall that everybody brought their dish every week, right? And you brought that in, and after church, you went to fellowship. And you all kind of had that pot luck, or you can't have luck in church, so it was the pot blessing. You guys know what I'm saying, right? And so there's no such thing as luck with Jesus. So we got the pot blessing. I'm very blessed to receive that fried chicken that Susie made. So I'm going to go get a hold of some of that. And so we had that time, right? And that was fellowship. But fellowship really means this. It means unity. It means oneness. It means we're connected to one another. We're family. We're in love with one another. And now there's that community, right? Now we're communing, we're joining together. So they continued, yes, in the apostles' doctrine, but also in fellowship. Now look at the next part. They did have the pot luck, or I'm sorry, the pot blessing, because we're in church, right? And so they had in the breaking of bread. That means they ate together. But not only did they eat together, look at the very end, and in prayers. So we see there was a spiritual element of what they did, but also there was a natural, relational element of what they did. Not only doctrine, but also fellowship. Not only the breaking of bread, but in prayers. Maybe you've been coming to church for a while and you don't know anybody yet, but it might be time for you to start branching out, start reaching out. Maybe it's time for you to get involved in a small group or an interest group, or, you know, maybe if you serve like Pastor Luke was saying. start to meet people. And then maybe as you're sitting there, you say, hey, you know what? You want to go over to the Little Rock Cafe and break some bread? What do you mean break some bread? Well, they've got, you know, burgers, or maybe you don't break bread. Maybe you don't like bread. So you break a tortilla or something like that, you know. And that's what you like to do. So, hey, you start to eat together. And as you're talking, hey, how was your week? Oh, man, my week was so tough. Boss is on my case. I go home. Husband or wife is just going crazy. Kids are driving me nuts. Bills are on the table. I don't know what to do. Well, guess what? Not only breaking bread, but hey, brother, let's pray. Hey, sister, come on, let's talk about this from the Word of God. Let's get a hold of what God has to say. And then we're going to believe God according to His Word. And we're going to see what God does in your life. See, there was a spiritual aspect, but also there was a relational aspect of what they did. The second thing that we see in the Word that the Bible calls the church, right? Not only a family, but also a house. Church is a house. Maybe you never heard that before, but that's why we're called building a passionate house. This is the house of God. And the house of God is a place not just where we come to church, but really we are the temple of the Holy Spirit now, right? We're the house. Jesus sends His Spirit and lives on the inside of each and every one of us. And the Bible tells us, Peter actually writes, and he says that we are all being built into a spiritual house. Let me show you what this looks like for a second. Okay, my buddy T, come on up here, man. I got a job for you. Okay, Megan, will you come up here? All right, let me get Megan here. And then I need Pastor Joe. Pastor Joe, why don't you come on up here? And Larry, will you come on up? Okay, and then let me see who else I can get. My buddy Bob. Bob, will you come on up here? Okay, all right. Now we've got a house. Now T-Bone, I got a specific job for you. You're gonna like this. T-Bone gets to be Jesus today. So come on up right here, man. Right, yeah, he's got the hair for it this week. So, okay, come on up. Now, Jesus, the Bible says, is the cornerstone, right? He's the foundation. He's the one that the church is built on. Okay, so God puts people in churches, right? He's the one that's building us into a living house. But if you think about that illustration, here's Megan, right? So Megan, come on up. And just link arms right here. Link arms right here, okay? So Megan's right there, okay? Now, Pastor Joe, come on over here. Pastor Joe, okay? So Jesus is putting order in the church, right? He's building a spiritual house. But notice that we were never meant to be alone in this. Not meant to be individualized. He's building us together. So here comes Larry. All right, now Larry, come on up here. All right, and then Bob, come on up. All right, so Bob's over here. Now, let's say this is the house of God right here, okay? This is the Rock Church. There we are. Now, the devil looks at that, and the devil says, you know what? That Pastor Joe, he's doing a lot of good things with the youth and the young adults, and I'm going to try and take him out. So I'm going to attack his marriage, and I'm going to attack Pastor Joe. You better stay strong, brother, okay? So I'm going to attack his marriage, and I'm going to attack his kids, right? And that little Judah, he was born with problems, and so I'm going to come after him. And then that little Madeline, I'm going to get after him. But the devil's not doing too much. Why? Because Pastor Joe is only so strong on his own, but when Megan and when Larry is holding on to him, now the devil, yeah, he can't get after him, right? So the devil backs off Pastor Joe, mighty man of faith. But Bob's a new Christian. This is just an illustration. Bob's been in the Lord for a long time, traveling all over the world telling people about Jesus. But in our illustration, this new guy, man, he's not connected. He's on the fray. I'm going to get Bob out of there. Bob, you know, Bob, it's really cold this morning, and the bed feels really good. And you know, the game's on, Bob. Bob, the game is on. Come on, you can't. Listen, they'll be having church again next week. They won't have this game next week. But Larry's holding on to Bob. Larry noticed Bob wasn't in church one week, and Larry called Bob, and the devil was trying to get him, but Larry's holding on to him. See, we're family. We're connected. See, it not only speaks of family, but it also speaks of our form. Thank you, guys. You guys can have a seat. You guys are wonderful. Which brings us to the third thing for today. If we're going to build a passionate house, not only do we have to know our passion for God, have a compassion for the lost, and a passionate love for one another, but finally, we've got to have a passion for our purpose. Not only do we have a place in the house of God, but like every family, you've got a place at the table, and you've got a job afterwards cleaning up, right? You're going to scrape the dishes. You're going to wash. You're going to rinse. You're going to dry. You're going to put away. Everybody has everything. You're going to take out the trash, right? That's usually Dad's job for some reason. I don't know how Dad always gets the job of taking out the trash. Someday my kids are going to grow up, and that's going to be their job. All of us have a place, and all of us have a purpose. And when you find out your purpose, when you find out the reason why God brought you to this house, in this place, at this time, and when you recognize and realize that God has a job for you to do, and you get flowing in your purpose, you'll find your passion. Let me show it to you in the Word in Ephesians, the fourth chapter. Turn there with me in Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter number 4, we're going to take a look at a couple of verses. We're going to read verse number 11 through verse number 16. A lot of verses, but I believe you guys can handle it. Ephesians 4th chapter, verse number 11, it says this, and he himself, speaking of Jesus, remember, capital H, is talking about God, talking about Jesus. He himself gave some, everybody say some. And not for everybody. There are some. He himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers. Okay? Now, often when we read these verses, we look at that and we say, oh man, wouldn't it be great to be an apostle? Think about that, breaking new ground and going out to the mission fields and starting churches and overseeing the work of the ministry. My goodness, that would be really neat. Wouldn't it be wonderful to be an evangelist and travel around and tell people about Jesus and have the signs of an evangelist, you know, miracles, signs and wonders, and scores of people coming to the Lord? That'd be really neat. Wouldn't it be awesome to be a prophet, to foretell and to foretell the will and the counsel of God, and to be able to speak the word of the Lord? Man, that would be wonderful. Wouldn't it be so cool to be a pastor or a teacher? You know, but I guess only the chosen few can be that, because he only gave some, and I must not be some of those people. And we discredit ourselves and we look down on ourselves. But I want you to know something. At the end of that verse, there is not a period. The end of that verse, there is a comma. In other words, the thought is not done yet. What's the next verse, the first word in the next verse, verse number 12? What does that three-letter little word right there say? Okay. Now that you got a hold of it, now that you know the answer, let's try it again. Everybody tell me, what is that little three-letter word right there at the beginning of verse number 12?
Four.
In other words, there is a reason. There is a purpose that God only gave some to be the what's called the five-fold ministry gifts that we see there. For the equipping of the saints. Now, maybe you came into this place and you thought, I'm just a sinner saved by grace. I'm not really worth anything. I'm not really worthy to do anything. My background tells me that I can't be anything. And I guess because I'm not a part of that fivefold ministry, I'm not really worth much but to sit in a church and make the pastor feel good about himself. But I'm here to tell you today, that is not the way God made the church to work. God has a place, but God also has a purpose. And my purpose as a pastor is to equip the saints. Who are the saints? The saints are those who are born of the Spirit of God. If you have been born again, that old sinner, that old man, yes, he got saved by grace, but guess what? He died. He went to the cross with Jesus. He was buried in the grave, and now a new man has been resurrected and raised up, and now you're no longer that old sinner. You are a saint of Almighty God. And therefore, my job as pastor is to equip the saints. Can I say it in modern day IE terminology? All y'all. To equip the saints, look at this, for, here's the purpose, equip the saints for what? For the work of the ministry. Wait a second. I thought the pastors, the teachers, the evangelists, the prophets, and the apostles were doing the work of the ministry. No, we are equipping the saints to do the work of the ministry. Doesn't matter if you're not paid by the church. Doesn't matter if you don't have a title or a card, prophet, so-and-so, apostle, whatever it is. That doesn't matter. You are a full-time minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ. You got a job to do. You are the West Coast distributor of God's goodness. You have a place, but you also have a purpose to do the work of the ministry. Look at this, for the edifying of the body of Christ. That word edifying is really kind of like a construction term. You heard of an edifice, right? It's a tall structure, it's strong, right? So the edifying would be to be the strengthening or the building up of the body of Christ. Now let's look at this. Look at this, verse 13. Till we all come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Now that word perfect really means complete. In other words, we are building the body of Christ. We're building what God is building. We're building the church of Almighty God. And our place and our purpose, if we're placed in this house, then our purpose is to build this house, to put our hearts into it, to have that strong emotional connection to it. It's our intense desire, and now it's our fervent activity. And as you get equipped, you go out from this place, and whether it be in the ministries here on campus or outside, or maybe it's in business, maybe your job is to finance, maybe your job is to pray, maybe your job is to serve, maybe your job is to teach, maybe your job is to outreach, whatever your job is, that as you do that, it strengthens and it builds the body of Christ. And look at what it says, to the fullness, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Some people have a little bitty Jesus and they want to keep him that way. God is something. Yeah, you can have your Jesus, you can have your cake, you could eat it too, right? You could still be out there in the world, you could still be doing your thing. You know, you got to build a business. You've got to leave a mark here on the earth. Build your fame, build your fortune, build your thing, and you can still thank God for it at the end. And yet that's not what I see in the Bible. The Bible says, I'm going to put everything until we all come to a perfect man, complete. See, we're not complete until the job is done. Either till they put me in a box in a grave or until Jesus comes and calls us all home, the job isn't done yet. We have a job till we become a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. I don't have a little bitty Jesus. We've all got a great big Jesus, and we are growing up, and we are edifying, and we are building up to the fullness of the stature of Jesus Christ. See, when I look around the churches all over the world, we have only just begun, church. This is just a little Bible study compared to what God wants to do in the Inland Empire. Not just this church, but multiple churches. God wants to pour out His Spirit. God wants to save souls. God wants to fill up the pews. God wants to fill up the seats. God wants to fill up the hearts. He wants His glory to cover the earth. That's the measure of the fullness of the stature of Jesus Christ. Because if the church is going to stand up and be what it's called to be, it's got a long ways to go. That's why we're building a passionate house. Look at what it says, verse 14, that we should no longer be children, tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the trickery of men and the cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting. That's why we come to church, we get built up, we get equipped, we get the doctrines from a place that we trust so that when the other winds of doctrines blow through, we're not knocked out or knocked off, right? And then it goes on, verse 15, but speaking the truth in love. See, there's going to be opportunity for offense, but if we can stay in love, if we can stay in faith, if we can stay together, speaking the truth in love, may grow up. Church, sometimes we get so offended over such stupid things. I didn't like the way they said that to me. Get over it. My goodness. I didn't like the music style. You know, they're changing the music, and they just cater to the young. You know what I mean? And sometimes it's not about that. Listen, the music at this church is kind of like the weather in the Midwest. Just wait a minute, and it'll change. One minute we're doing reggae, next minute somebody's rapping, then we're doing a hymn, we're doing some tender song, everybody's on their face. It's like the video announcements, right? It's the same thing. We're on this roller coaster. We don't know what's going on. We're a little bit, you know, jittery and a little bit different. You know, we can't sit still long enough. So just wait a little bit. But can I tell you something? We're going to start painting some walls different colors. Don't get offended over the color of the stupid wall. It doesn't matter any bit in eternity what color the wall is, or the carpet is, or the stage is, or my jacket, or Pastor Luke wearing jogger pants in the pulpit. None of that matters. Let's grow up. Let's walk in love. Let's stay in faith, and let's stay together. We're better together than we are apart. I digress. May grow up into all things into him who is the head, Christ. See, we're going to be more and more like Jesus, looking more and more like he is. Verse 16, from whom the whole body, there we are again, the body of Christ, from whom the whole body joined and knit together by what every joint supplies. See, everybody has a part. Everybody has a place. Everybody has a purpose. You have something to give. Look at according to the effective working by which every part does its share. God has not asked me to do your share any more than he's asked you to do my share. No, God has a place. God has a purpose for each and every one of us individually. And God has not called me to do all of your job. God has called you to do your job. Got me to do my job. I'll do my job. You do your job together as we effectively work. Look at what happens. Look at what happens. Look at what happens. Verse 16. Look at every part does it share. Causes growth of the body for the edifying of itself in love. The building up of itself in love. Love is our motivating factor. Love is our reason. Love is our cause. Love is our call. Love is what we are motivated by. And as we do our part, it's going to build passionate house, build a strong and healthy house. We're going to continue to grow. Oh my goodness, God has a plan and a purpose for all of us. See, when you are flowing in your purpose, you'll find your passion. If you're just sitting there doing nothing, man, yeah, I went to church, it was good. But when you're flowing in your purpose, you'll find your passion. Romans 12 chapter, turn there with me, Romans chapter number 12. Oftentimes we like Romans 12, 1 and 2. Great verses. Should memorize them. They're wonderful. But as you keep reading in the book of Romans, chapter 12, you'll find that it starts talking about the same terminology, the body of Christ. And in Romans chapter 12, just to drive the point home today, verse number 5 and verse number 6, look at what it says. So we being many are one body in Christ and individually members of one another. In other words, you can't get away from us. We're connected. Jesus put us together. You might be the finger bone, but the finger bone is connected to the wrist bone. The wrist bone's connected to the arm bone. The arm bone's connected to the shoulder bone, right? We're connected in Christ. So we being many are one in the body of Christ and individually members of one another. Verse number 6, having then gifts differing according to the grace that is given to us. Maybe you didn't know this, but when you receive Jesus, you have been given gifts. God made you the way that you are for a reason. God wanted a you when he made you. That's why he broke the mold after he made it. There's only one you. It's like a snowflake or like your fingerprint, right? No two are alike. You are individually you, and God has graced you. He has empowered you. Grace is God's sovereign, divine ability to get the job done on our behalf when we can't do it. Maybe you never thought of yourself as a minister. Maybe you never saw yourself as somebody who had a purpose. And yet, God says, I have a place for you at the table, but I have a plan for your life, and I've got a purpose for you to get busy here in the house. You say, but oh, hold on a second. I don't know my giftings. I don't know what my calling is. I don't know my purpose. Well, just take a look at what you have in your hand. Start there. See, if you start somewhere, it's like being in a car. If the Holy Spirit's the driver, right, he turns the wheel, but the car's not going anywhere. No movement on the tires. All that's going to happen, those tires are going to turn like this, right? But you're not going in the direction. But if you get started and you start rolling, the Holy Spirit can then turn the wheel and say, yeah, you're starting here, but I'm going to bring you over here. And you'll find out your purpose. But start with what's in your hand. Just like Moses, when he was going to deliver the children of Israel, God says, what's in your hand? He says, it's a shepherd's rod. In the wilderness, 40 years as a shepherd, little did he know he would be shepherding the children of Israel. In the same way, what's in your hand? Maybe you're a stay-at-home mom, and all you do is sit around and change poopy diapers all day. Well, can I tell you something? We have a ministry that does that. You would be wonderful at it. He said, but Pastor, I do that all day. I don't want to do that at church. Okay, then come on over to the women's ministry. They would love to get you involved in being a table leader, talking to a lady. Can you smile and shake someone's hand? We have a ministry that does that. I'm just a Stater Brothers grocery bagger. That's all I do all day, every day. We have a ministry that does groceries called the Food Distribution Center, Tuesdays and Thursday mornings. Maybe you could come and help out with that. Maybe you're the introvert of all introverts. Pastor, when I think about working with people, it freaks me out. And I'd rather hide behind a computer screen. We have a ministry that does that. Maybe you want to get involved with social media or photography, or maybe you want to use your giftings as a check-in tech or something like that. See, we've got all kinds. That's one of the benefits of coming to a big church like this. What do you want to do? Most likely we have a ministry that doesn't, and if we don't, we'll create one just so that you can get busy doing something. Hello? I said hello. I mean, we're talking about you getting busy doing something. Because you've been graced, and you have a gift, and you have a place, but you also have a purpose here in the house. And as much as we need a pastor, as much as we need a prophet, as much as we need the apostles, listen, we need the body of Christ to get busy doing the work of the ministry. Drop down to verse number 11. Verse number 11 after talks about all the different kinds of ministries that you could do. Look at this, verse number 11. Not lagging in diligence. Fervent in spirit. That sounds like passion, doesn't it? Look at this, serving the Lord. You're not serving me. You're not serving the church. You're serving Jesus when you serve his house. That's what this is really all about. Listen, guys, we have everything to give and nothing to lose. Because even if you gave it all of your resource, all of your money, all of your time, all of your talent, all of your effort, if you put it all out there and you gave it all, but you still had Jesus, you would still have everything. We have everything to give and nothing to lose. Don't let anything hold you back from serving the Lord with passion this coming year, loving people, compassionate for the lost, loving God, and going all out for Jesus. When I land in heaven, I want to come crashing through those gates on E. I don't want to have anything left. I want to leave it all out here on the table. I want to spend and be spent so that when I show up in heaven, I crash land and they say, praise the Lord, you left it all out there. The amazing thing to me is that the more you give, you can never outgive God. And we think, if I give, I won't have. Listen, even if I didn't, it wouldn't matter. But you can continue to give and give and give and give, and God will continue to pour out his blessings, resource your life, and you will leave a legacy, an impact, not here on the earth, but in eternity. That's what this is all about, you guys. That's what this is all about, building a passionate house in 2016. Passion for God, compassion for the lost, passionate love for one another, and passion for our purpose. We have everything to give and nothing to lose. Can you say amen? Amen? Now, quickly, before some of you guys jump up and leave, you hear claps and you think, that's my time to leave. Got a couple of things. I just wanted to throw some things out and just speak some things in front of the church. I wanted to say these things because I'll define for all of us why that is a little bit later. But I want to get some things in your heart. I want to get you some things maybe you can pray about, or maybe you could see by faith. You can get your faith out there, and you could see yourself being involved in these areas, okay? Now, this is not everything that's on our hearts. There's outreaches. There's different things that we want to do that we have not done yet. We have not yet gotten into the foster care system. That'd be great to be able to do. There's prison ministries we want to do. I would love to live stream not only around the world, but live stream in the prisons, live stream in the convalescent hospitals, bring church to people who cannot come. You know, those are some things, but I wanted to just give you a couple things that you, maybe some things that you're going to see this year or might see or might not see. We may not even do some of this stuff, okay? So first thing is this, is just enhancing the series. Like last week, you saw the production, right? We'd love to involve more video, more dramatic presentations, lighting, sound, all that kind of stuff. And so we're going to enhance the series. Welcome and assistance, right? Some of you guys, when you came last week for the first time, you were welcomed by somebody before church even started. And so they want to eventually get that all the way out into the parking lot. I think we got like 3 or 4 guys out there in the parking lot. You know, church this size, we should have like 20, 30, okay? So eventually we'd love to get more people that are welcoming people all the way from the parking spot over here to the drop their kids off, to find the restrooms, to find a seat, to feel welcome here at the house so that their hearts can be open to the things of God more and more. They're developing that this year. Missions, that's another thing. Pastor Luke mentioned just yesterday they had a meeting. They're going all over the world in missions, Mongolia. They're going to Israel. They're going to Peru with the youth and young adults. They're going to go to Madagascar. I mean, just some crazy stuff. So they're developing missions. Some of you guys might be thinking, what about church plants, Pastor? What about that, you know, reaching out and building churches and all that kind of stuff? That's our seventh pillar. That's on our hearts. I don't know if that's going to happen this year or not. Probably not, because the Lord hasn't spoken yet. But when God does, God will raise up leadership. God will raise up people who are able to do that. And he'll also give us the plan. It may not look like some of the church plants we've done in the past, where it's, you know, autonomous and they're out there and we're over here. And you know, sometimes we meet up and we appreciate each other and send each other to each other's churches when we find somebody that lives in that area. Maybe we'll do satellite. Maybe we'll do something where, you know, it's an outreach to people that drive a long distance to get here, and they can build community in their area and still have this church. I don't know what that looks like, but the Lord's going to lead us. The Lord will speak to us. How about this? Sports ministry. You know, how many of you guys like sports? Okay, we've got a couple people out there. Oh, my goodness, we've got a lot of people out there. You guys like to play sports, right? And so we haven't had like a small groups ministry that's really, you know, done this at a large scale. I'd love to see baseball team and basketball and soccer, you know, some of that kind of stuff or whatever it is. They've got the run walk group that's coming up. Okay, some of you guys, all right, we got 300 people already that are going to run and walk that day. My whole family, we're going to walk. I think Pastor Jim said he wants to walk. And yeah, no, he's not going to walk. No, he's preaching that weekend. So he's got to save it for the pulpit. But anyways, we'll see if we can talk him into it. But you know, there's stuff that's developing this year with that. And if you'd like to be a part of that, Dr. Becker, wave at everybody. This is Dr. B. All right, Dr. Becker, you can talk to him about maybe being a part of that. Just had a guy that trains Olympic athletes come up after the first service and say, I'd love to be a part of that. I believe God's spoken to me. So, you know, you might be bumping elbows with the best of them in that ministry. Drama ministry, you know, used to be that we had full-on productions and plays and hundreds of people we could save. I'd love to see that happen. You know, maybe do a summer series where there's a vignette every week or something. I don't know, you know. It'd be cool. At the very least, you know, sermon illustrations and stuff like that. It'd be great to have a drama ministry. How about this? A boomers task force. Okay. All the millennials are going, what's a boomer? Can you? I'm not in on the joke. No, but a boomer's task force, you know what? That is one of the most untapped people groups in the church because they feel like, well, I'm just going to let the young guys do their thing. They need to do this. I've done it for years. But listen, you have the wisdom. You've got the knowledge and the understanding. Some of you guys have retired and you've got the time. Maybe you don't have the strength you used to have, but we'll get you some of those millennials to get in there that are passionate and want to go and lift 50 pounds over their head and, you know, do all that kind of stuff while the girls are taking selfies with them and everything, you know. But at least you can get some stuff done. Okay, you move that to there and quit taking pictures of yourself, posting them on the internet. But a boomer's task force, my goodness, what could we do if we mobilize people in the body of Christ? How about this? All the properties around us right now are for sale. A couple of million bucks. I would love to purchase every last one of them and expand what we're doing. I'd love to see our school built. I'd love to see a larger food distribution center built with some storage. Storage has been a real problem at this church. You guys saw all those beautiful Christmas decorations? We were kind of freaking out, wondering where we were going to put them. By the way, I don't think I told you guys, but a gentleman gave us a storage container, 40-foot last church service that... brand new, empty, well, new to us, He'd been using it. So anyways, but I'd love to see a storage facility that's built. I'd love to see, you know, maybe a clinic built. I'd love to see transitional housing. I would love to see, you know, just not just a little resource center of a house. I'd love to see a storefront, massive, taking care of the needs of people. So, but all that's going to happen. Now you say, Pastor, why say that? Why are you teasing us with vision if it's not going to happen? Why would you give us false hope? I turn to the Word, Ezra chapter 8. Verse number 21 through verse number 23. Remember, Pastor Luke used this illustration about fasting when we introduced the topic of a fast. Here's Ezra. He's got a vision in his heart, and he's got a purpose. He's going to go build the house of God. He's going to go lead the people of Israel. And so here he is traveling, and he's spoken some things. Now, I want you to see this. Ezra chapter 8, verse number 21 starts out, "Then I proclaimed a fast there at the river Ahava, that we might humble ourselves before our God, to seek from him the right way for us and our little ones, and all our possessions." In other words, remember how I started this? This is not my vision. This is the vision of the Holy Spirit delivered to me that I'm now delivering to you. So the vision that I just gave you, if it is not God's will for us to do some of those things, maybe drama ministry, maybe some of those things are not the will of God this year. But that's why we're fasting, and that's why we're seeking God, is for his way and not our way. Verse 22, "For I was ashamed to request of the king an escort of soldiers and horsemen to help us against the enemy on the road." Very dangerous traveling in those days, especially when they were delivered the articles of the house of God that they were to bring back. Gold, silver, precious items, very costly. They could have fell into the hands of robbers and thieves. But he says, "I was ashamed." Why was he ashamed? Look at this. "Because we had spoken." In other words, I let the cat out of the bag. I just stood up in front of you and I spoke a lot of things. But guess what? This is not about what I can do. It's not about what we can do. This is about what does God want us to do together. And therefore, I'm not going to request an escort from the king. I'm not looking to the government to do this. I'm not looking to an individual to fund this. I'm looking to Jesus right now. Look at this. "Because we had spoken to the king saying," look at what he says to the king. Look at what he says to the king. "The hand of our God is upon all those for good who seek him, but his power and his wrath are against all those who forsake him." We are clinging to Jesus in 2016 because it's God that's going to make this vision happen. Verse 23, look at this. "So we fasted and entreated our God for this." Maybe you caught some vision in the past 2 weeks. Maybe God spoke something to your heart. Maybe today you finally saw your place. Maybe today you finally saw your purpose. I would encourage you, if you're not fasting yet, that you would maybe decide to fast. Choose something. Maybe choose a day or a meal. Or maybe choose a time that you're not going to eat after at night. Or maybe you choose a certain type of foods like meats or coffee or something like that. But fast. But not only fast, but pray. Entreat God for this. Whatever this is in your heart, whatever this is in your life. And at the very least, pray for this church. Pray for its leaders. Pray for its future. Pray for its finances. Pray for the house. Entreat God for the vision that we would be able to build a passionate house in 2016. Look at the last part of the sentence, "and he answered our prayer." God, at the end of this year, we will be able to say, God has answered our prayer. He's faithful. He's faithful. I want to end today where God began with me on this journey, when I started to pray about the vision and where God took me. 2 Chronicles chapter 36, verse number 23. God gave me this word, and I believe that this is a prophetic word for our church. 2 Chronicles chapter 36, the children of Israel have been taken, scattered. They've been cast out because they didn't serve the Lord. But there came a time when God started to gather the children of Israel back together. And look at what it says in 2 Chronicles chapter 36, verse number 23. "Thus says Cyrus, king of Persia, all the kingdoms of the earth the Lord God of heaven has given me, and he has commanded me to build him a house." What are we talking about doing this year? Building a passionate house. "He's commanded me to build him a house at Jerusalem, which is in Judah. Who is among you of all his people?" I would ask the church today, will the real church please stand up? If you are a saint of Almighty God, God has a place, God has a plan, and God has a purpose for your life. Who is among you who will do this great work of building a passionate house? Look at the last words, what it says. May the Lord his God be with him and let him go up. Listen, we are not getting dragged down this year. We're not going down. We're not stopping. We're not letting off. We're not holding back. This year, we're going to build a passionate house, and we are going to go up. Hallelujah. Glory to God. 2016 is going to be an awesome and exciting year ahead. Can you say amen? God is good. Give the Lord a great big praise today if you got something from the Word of God. Before anybody gets up, before anybody leaves, I just want to take a couple more minutes of your time, then I'll let you go. Okay, there's some leave early sections on the sides. Those guys are welcome to go, and they're going to prepare to serve you at the tables and the booths that are outside. So they're getting up, they're leaving. But everybody else, please remain seated during this time. This is not your cue to get up and run out. Because God wants to speak to you right where you're at. We've talked a lot today about the church, talked about the place, talked about the family, talked about our form and our function, talked about the body of Christ and how you can do your part. Well, you can't do that unless you're a part of the body of Christ, unless you're a Christian. Sometimes people get all screwed up when they start to think about God and they start to think about eternity, start to think about heaven and hell. Some people deny hell. They say, you know, hell's offensive. If God is love and he died for us, then isn't hell closed and heaven's open and now everybody gets to go? It doesn't matter what we do here on the earth any longer because God loves us so much. He just overlooks all that stuff. And now all roads lead to heaven. You do your thing, I'll do my thing. Everybody out there in the churches, they can do whatever they want to do. We'll all make it there somehow, some way, whatever you call heaven. But listen, do you think that God's a fool? What if I said to you, all roads on the earth lead to the moon? You'd say you're crazy. You could drive around the earth as long as you want. You will never make it to the moon. In the same way, what makes us think we can do whatever we want and we'll end up in heaven? It doesn't work like that. In fact, if you read your Bible, the Bible says that wide is the road that leads to destruction. That means there's going to be a lot of people that end up going to hell. And he says, narrow is the path that leads to life, and there are few who find it. Today, will you let me just shine some light on the path for you? How do we know that we're a Christian? How do we know that we're headed for heaven and denying hell? Sometimes people think, well, if you're just good enough, if you can do enough good deeds, if you can be nice to your neighbors and friendly to people, get involved in social justice causes, helping people dig wells in third world countries or putting shoes on your feet that put shoes on feet of underprivileged children, that if I can do enough good, that God will see that and appreciate that and that God will let me into heaven. But did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that you can be good enough to get to go to heaven? It doesn't work like that. In fact, the Bible says that our goodness compared to God's goodness, like filthy rags, going to get thrown out. And all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. You're not going to make it to heaven just by being good. Sometimes people think, well, if I can attend enough church, sit in a seat in a sanctuary, warm up a spot enough times, God will see my attendance. If I consider myself to be a Christian, or I was raised as a Christian, parents told me you were Christians growing up, hung a cross or St. Christopher around your neck, had you baptized or christened as a child, went to religious classes like Sunday school or catechism class, maybe Sabbath school class growing up. You've always thought of yourself as a Christian. Born in America, America's a Christian nation. Everybody born in America is going to heaven. We're not any other religions. We're not Buddhist, Muslim, Hindus. Therefore, we're Christians, right? Wrong. You know that nowhere in the Bible does it say you can attend enough church, sit in a seat in a sanctuary, warm up a spot, call yourself a Christian, that makes you a Christian. It's like me saying, I'm going to go be a fish. So I'm going to go sit in the Pacific Ocean and call myself a fish long enough, and that'll make me a fish. No, just a pruny, slimy human sitting in the water. You can't attend enough church. You can't be raised in church. Call yourself a Christian. That makes you a Christian. You can't do enough good works in order to make your way into heaven. Doesn't matter how much you know. Sometimes people think, well, if I just know enough, if I can quote enough scripture, if I can talk about Jesus enough, maybe if I volunteer in church and teach in the Bible classes, carry the pastor's Bible, get a membership card, that'll make me a Christian. But you know that God's not looking for your membership card to a church before you can enter the gates of heaven? He's not looking to find out if you have a volunteer hours sheet for how much good stuff you did in church. It's not how it works. And if you'd read your Bible, you would know that nowhere, check it out, nowhere in the Bible said that you could know enough about God that somehow that knowledge up here in your head makes you right with God. Because even the demons believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. They're not Christians. You'll find the devil himself quoting Scripture in your Bible. Read it. Open it up. Matthew chapter 4. You'll find the devil quoting Scripture. And yet that doesn't make him a Christian. So everybody look up here at me for a second. This is not about what you have in your head. It's not about having mental assent towards God, knowing who Jesus is, and that gets you right. But rather, this is about your heart. You become a Christian, part of the family of God, part of the house, part of the body. When you give God all of your heart, and you give God all of your life. That's the only way you're going to go to heaven and deny your presence in hell. Jesus said it like this. He said, you must be born again. Now, I know our society's made a mockery out of that term. They've raked it through the coals. But let's not let Hollywood movies, television, books, and the internet define for us what being born again is. What does being born again really mean from the Bible? Well, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing. It means you've given God all of your heart, and you've given God all of your life. It's just that simple. It's all or nothing with Jesus. Let me prove it to you. Last book of the Bible, book of Revelation. Jesus is speaking to a church, just like he's speaking to us here in this church today. And he says, when I come, I want to find you hot, or I want to find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I'll vomit you from my mouth. Now, what does lukewarm mean? Well, it's a little in, little out, little up, little down, little token prayer every now and again, an occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. And you're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with Jesus, you're not going to make it. How do I know that? Because only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. So today, I'm going to give you an opportunity. Let's do this God's way. Remember, the path is narrow and there are few who find it. Jesus said this. He said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you as mine before my Father in heaven. But if you deny me, I will deny you. Today, your call, your choice. You can sit there and do nothing when you know you need to get right with God. Or you can choose to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Here's how this is going to work. I'm going to count to three in a moment. One, two, three. When I say three, I'm going to pop my hands together. Bang! When you hear the sound of my hands popping together just like that, bang, that's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart, I want to give God all my life, I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up, I'll count it, you can put it right back down. You might be thinking, whoa, 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 wait a second, time out. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. Yes, you might be. Let's get over that today, because think of the trade-off. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment than just end up in hell forever and ever and ever? No one make that trade. Listen, you're amongst family today. You're joining the family of God. You're going to be born again. There's no criticism, no judgment, no condemnation. Today, there's loving people who are excited about your life. We've all done this. Now it's your turn. Will you give God all of your heart? Will you give God all of your life? I'm going to ask everybody one more time. Focus in right now. Devil's trying to distract you, trying to get you off. But this is your eternal life we're talking about right now. This is your eternal destiny that's at stake. See, more people are getting up right now. Listen, guys, stay seated, because you don't know if you're getting up and walking out is going to be a distraction to somebody who's trying to focus in on their life. And they're going to end up in hell because we couldn't wait to get up. I'm going to ask everybody, please, one more time. I'm pleading with you. Stay put. Love someone enough right now to pray for them and to encourage them by allowing them this moment of focus. All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, watching by television, in the foyer, down at the Love Rock Cafe, come on, put the burger down, get ready to get your hand up. If you're watching online, wherever you're at, across the nation and around the world, get ready to get your hand up. God sees and God's watching you. And then right after that, you can minimize your video browser and click the blue button which says respond to God, or go to our homepage, rockchurch.com, and find the tab on the right-hand side that says how to know God. Someone will lead you in a prayer and we'll get some information to you about your walk with God. I'm going to count to three, pop my hands together. Who should raise their hand if you've been running from God instead of to God? I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Today's your day. Make sure. Who should raise their hand if you've never done this before, never said yes to Jesus, given him all of your heart and all of your life? I'm speaking to you. Or finally, who should raise their hand if you're lukewarm in this place? You know that's the condition of your heart when I described it. Get ready to get your hand up. I'm going to count to three, pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me right now. There's one, two, three, four. Thank you. Five, six. Got you over there. Seven, eight. Got you right there. Eight wise people already. Eight wise people already. Nine, ten. Got you over there. Thank you. 11 up there in the family room. Got you up there. 12 up there in the family room. Thank you. 12, 13 up there. Got you. Thank you. 13 wise people already. 13. Got you guys already. Thank you. 14 up on top over there. Got you back there. Thank you. God bless you. Anybody else real quick that I did not already see? There's about 14 wise people. Anybody else need to give God all of your heart and need to give God all of your life? Anybody else real quick? There's 15 right here. Thank you. 15 wise people. Anybody else real quick that I didn't already see? If you're sitting there wondering if you should do this, yeah, you should. Go for it. Come on. I didn't embarrass them and I won't embarrass you. Anybody else? About 15 wise people. Anybody else? All right, let's give the Lord a great big praise. Hallelujah. All right, all 15 of you, or if you're number 16, 17, 18, 19, or 20, you should have raised your hand, but you didn't. You little rascals, come on. It's not too late for you. Here's what we're going to do. We're all going to stand, give a clap and a shout. Reverend Elijah's going to lead us in a song. As he does, that's your cue. Get your stuff, coat, purse, sweater, Bible, a friend if you need a friend. Once you get in the aisle and meet me up front, because we're going to change destinies today. Can't do that till we get you down here. So if that's you, you raise your hand, or you should have raised your hand, you come right now. Come on, let's welcome them. You come. Come on down. Come on down. They're coming. Let's give them a hand. You can come too. Anybody else, if you need to come, you just make your way to the front right now. Come on down. They're still coming. Come on, you can come too. We're in the family rooms. Come on down. You raise your hand, or if your children raise their hand, bring them. Bring them down. They're welcome right now. Come on. They're still coming. They're still coming. Come on, you can come too. Hallelujah, they're still coming. Come on, you need to come. Just make your way to the front right now. Come on down. Come on down. Hey guys, all right, they're still coming. Praise the Lord. We'll wait one more minute for you guys. Come on down. If you need to come while I'm talking and giving some instruction, just make your way to the front. You know, maybe you want to nudge your neighbor and say, hey, if you need to go, I'll go with you right now. Okay, you can come during this time. Hi. Best decision of your life right here. Put a smile on your face. This is a good thing. This is not a bad thing. You're leaving the old ways, that old man behind. Now, that old sinner, dead, in the grave, crucified with Jesus, gone. Now you got a new life. Right? Brand new. You are now a saint of Almighty God. You have a place. This is your home. This is your house. You have a purpose. God loves you so much. Right over here to my right, your left. See this guy waving at you? This is Reverend Antonio. He's a real good guy, okay? Nothing weird's going to go on. You know, sometimes you go to church, you wonder, are they weird? Listen, he's cool, all right? You can tell by the jacket he's wearing, he's cool, okay? He's going to do three things. He's going to lead you in a prayer to invite Jesus in your heart. You're going to be born again. Secondly, he's going to give you some free information, some free literature to find out what to do next in your walk with God. Then he's going to introduce you to one of your family members. We call them spiritual personal trainers, but really it's just a friend in church who will come alongside you, teach you some things out of the Bible and encourage you. It's easy. It's free. He'll describe how it works, and then he'll let you come right back out. Okay? Love you guys so much. If you guys will make a left turn and follow Reverend Antonio right this way, let's give him a hand as they go. Hallelujah. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise today.